Good morning, church. We welcome you this morning to the River Bible Church. It is beautiful outside, isn't it? Spring is here. My name is Bridget, and I have just a couple of announcements for you this morning. First of all, a big thank you goes out to those who entered the Easter dessert contest. We actually had a tie for first place, and so both are going to be awarded this lovely Bake Off Champ spoon. And so it was a tie between Ruby and Amanda. So Amanda, come on up and get your spoon. I think Ruby will be at second service. Congratulations. Use that with pride the next time you're making desserts. All right, so the End Times class started this past Monday and was extremely well attended. I don't know if you guys saw the photos on our Facebook page. If you were not able to come, you are still invited for the next 7 weeks. This class is every Monday at 6:30 p.m. here in the sanctuary. Youth group will resume again on Wednesday at 6 p.m. All of those in grades 6 through 12 are invited for this midweek Bible study. If you are a camper and you would like to join Pastor Rich and Stacy in the UP, Upper Peninsula, I almost said in the Up. That would have been silly. You know when you're just reading in the Up? This July, for a casual week of camping and Bible study, you can check out the events page on our website for more information. It's going to be at the Black Point Resort, and you can make a reservation for a cabin or for a camping site on their website. Now, if you've been here for any length of time, that you know that the mission of the River Bible Church is loving, equipping, and going. That's right. Now, in order for this to happen, a church body must be unified and aligned. And our membership class walks you through how we carry out that mission as a church. If you would like to learn more about becoming a member of the River Bible Church, then you can sign up to attend our next membership class, which is going to be Saturday, April 20th from 9 to 11. And if you think that you are already a member, but you have not been contacted by a deacon or a deacon candidate in the last couple of months, then please talk to Stacy or April. Now, in the Bible, I really love this passage, and this is going to be familiar to a lot of you. James 2, 14 through 17, and it says, "What use is it, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but he has no works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or a sister is without clothing and in need of daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, be warmed and be filled,' and yet you do not give them what is necessary for their body, what use is that? Even so, faith, if it has no works, is dead, being by itself." And so, as you know, there are four ways that you can give here as members of our church. You can give on the Church Center app. You can give in the box on your way out today. You can give on our website, or if it's easier for you, you can mail a check directly to the church. If you are new, please do not feel obligated to give. The only thing we would ask is that you would fill out a connection card, which can be found in the seat back in front of you. And if you are new with us and have never filled one out, you can take that to the Welcome Center at the back of the sanctuary here, and we would love to just get a chance to connect with you after service. If you are joining us online and you have yet to fill out an online digital card, we would ask that you would do that as well so that we can be in touch with you this week and just get a chance to introduce ourselves and say hello. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we're so thankful for all of the things that you give us, the wealth that we have as just members of this church and this community. And we're just so thankful that we're able to then take what you give us and give it back to you in order to reach others, in order to just spread your name throughout our community and throughout the world. Lord, I ask that you would just bless this offering and those that provide it, and then allow us to use it as you would see fit. Lord, it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Morning. Let's stand together in worship. We want to welcome our brother and sister team, Abby and Eli, to our ministry team this morning. Let's sing about God's love. Continue to sing. For singing with us. You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. And good morning to those of you online. My name is Frank. This is our time for communion. So let's prepare our hearts and minds to go before the Lord. Yesterday we had men's breakfast, and one of the topics that came up was the topic of forgiveness, so I thought I would continue this morning with that same subject. Forgiveness plays such an important role in a Christian life, yet many of us struggle. We struggle with it. whether to ask for forgiveness or to offer forgiveness. It can be extremely difficult on what was said or done to us, and often pride and ego can get in the way of us doing what we know is right. Whether we are hurt verbally, emotionally, physically, or financially, it's our natural instinct to want to strike back and in some cases hold a grudge against the person who offended us. However, Jesus teaches us that we are to turn the other cheek. We are to humble ourselves and to forgive, because we all fall short of God's glory, and there's not one of us that is righteous, not one. In Matthew 18:22, it says, "Then Peter came and said to him, 'Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times?' And Jesus said to him, 'I do not say to you up to seven times, but 70 times seven.'" What Jesus is saying is that we are to always forgive. Not just when we're in a good mood or we feel like it. We are to forgive always. And at times this can be extremely difficult to do depending on the circumstances. And in those cases, it requires faith in God. But why would Jesus say forgive always? In Matthew 6:14, it says, "For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you." Here it comes. "But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you yours." Forgiveness comes full circle in what Jesus did on the cross for each and every one of us who are believers. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, it says, "God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Forgiveness was freely offered to each and every one of us on the cross, to those who believe in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And because of his death on the cross and the forgiveness of our sins, we are made righteous before God and have been given the gift of eternal salvation. So then, as Christians, how can we hold back offering forgiveness to others? The answer is we can't. We are to forgive always. Right now, some of you may be thinking of someone that you need to make amends with, someone you either need to ask forgiveness of or offer forgiveness to. It may be your husband, your wife, your child, a friend, a coworker. My advice is this: don't wait. None of us knows when we will take our last breath, and then it would be too late. Make today the day you make amends from the heart. Forgive freely as Jesus forgave us. The bread we are about to eat represents Christ's body on the cross, and the juice represents the blood that was shed as a new covenant for the forgiveness of our sins, past, present, and future. If you're not yet a Christ follower, we ask that you let the elements pass and use this time to ask God to come into your heart. And if after the service you'd like to speak with one of us, we'd love to meet you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you made the ultimate sacrifice on the cross for each and every one of us. You took our sins upon yourself and offered us complete forgiveness. And through the shedding of your blood on the cross, we were made righteous before God the Father and given the gift of eternal salvation. You showed us that we are to forgive freely, because yet while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Lord, those here who have amends to make with family members, friends, or coworkers, I pray that you would give them the strength, the courage to take the first step of forgiveness today, so that you would work to help restore those relationships. It's in your Son's precious and holy name I pray, Jesus Christ. Amen.
thought he was the one. We all thought he was the one. Everyone did. There was a party, and we were all there, and some woman comes in, and she has a bottle of perfume, expensive perfume, and she just pours it all over him. She did that because she thought he was the one. What a waste. We could have sold that perfume and used the money for a greater purpose. I tried to tell him as much, but he came back at me insinuating that he was the purpose. Even so, I believed he was the one. I believed that he was going to turn everything upside down. I just knew it. I mean, people would have followed him anywhere. All he had to do was just say the word, but he wouldn't say the word. Instead, my time has not yet come. That's what he would say over and over to me. My time has not yet come. Are you kidding me? He was raising people from the dead, for crying out loud. He was healing the blind, producing food out of thin air. My time has not yet come. So I forced his hand. I made his time come. Things needed to push, and I was the only one that had the courage to do it. We were all up there eating. We were all up there. He looks across the table to me, and he says, "Get on with it." How did he know what I was going to do? It wasn't about the money. It was not about the money. It's just when you have that kind of power that he has, why wouldn't you leverage it to forward the agenda? People listen to him. You know the sound a wave makes after it hits the shore? And how quiet it gets after a few seconds when it stops. That was Jesus. When he spoke, it was like a rolling wave. And the crowds listening, they were the hush at the end of the wave. Because when he spoke and you were there in his presence, there was no doubt in anyone's mind he was the one. What have I done?
I love how Paul greeted the church by saying, "Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord." What an amazing service we had last weekend. And I was really excited to be with you here again this weekend. Isn't it wonderful to be in a church that's so loving, so caring, and so interested in doing exactly what God has prescribed in his book? It's so needed today. It's so important, and I'm thankful that you feel the same way. You know, being a messenger of the Lord here in this beautiful little church is a daunting and yet fearful task, because I know that I'm held accountable for every word that I proclaim. You see, preachers are supposed to be truth brokers. We only have vested powers that's given to us through the Word of God. We must speak the Word of God, not our words meant to glorify ourselves. No, only to glorify God alone. And that's what I desire to do each and every Sunday, to get out of the way so that God can sanctify his people. Now, last week when I was talking about Judas, I claimed that he wasn't a Christian. And I hold to that statement today, not because of opinion, but because of biblical proof, which I'll give you today. I'll also make a case that Judas wasn't a Christian who just lost his salvation, no. But instead, he was never a true believer. And then I'll prove to you that a Christian, a true Christian, cannot be demon-possessed. But one of those proofs that I gave you on that Good Friday was wrong. I said that Judas became possessed by the devil. How could he possibly be a Christian? Because of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Now, this would be a true statement today. However, the disciples didn't have the Holy Spirit like we do today. The Holy Spirit didn't come to permanently indwell the Christian until after Jesus had ascended. In fact, look at this, John 14:16. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it does not see him or know him, but you know him, because he abides with you and will be what? In you. In you. So I thought that it would be good if on the heels of Easter, we talked a little bit more about Judas. About Judas, about Satan, about demons, and what that's causing in our world today. So before we begin, however, with the preaching of God's word, let's take a few moments and encourage those around us this morning. Let's go. All right, let's have a seat and grab our Bibles. I had to put the picture of Stacy's long-lost raccoon up there. Yes, he's no longer with us. He ran away, but we love him. We miss him so much. So don't be mean to raccoons. All right, let's open our Bibles. So as I described earlier, we'll be taking a break from John this Sunday, and we'll be moving to the book of Luke. If you could open your Bibles to Luke chapter 22, verses 1 through 6, as we look closer at the event with Judas. Luke 22, 1 through 6. When you're there, could you please stand for the reading of God's word?
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, church. Good morning to those that are watching online. I'm going to be reading Luke chapter 22, verse 1 through 6 in the NASB version. And it starts off, "Now the feast of the unleavened bread, which is called the Passover, was approaching. The chief priests and the scribes were seeking how they might put him to death, for they were afraid of the people. And Satan entered into Judas, who was called Iscariot, belonging to the number of the 12. And he went away in disgust with the chief priests and officers how he might betray him to them. They were glad and agreed to give him money. So he consented and began seeking a good opportunity to betray him to them apart from the crowd."
Amen. Thank you, man. You may be seated. Father, we come to you this morning with humble hearts, excited to read your word and hear it preached to us. God, it's very hard to understand this story with Judas and the betrayer. God, so will you help us with that? Will you help us to understand it? And then will you help us, Holy Spirit, to apply it to our lives? And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm sure you know this, but the most nefarious sin ever committed in the history of the world is the brutal, subhuman, sadistic murder of the morally perfect, sinless Son of God, Jesus. I mean, it doesn't get any worse than that. Of all the sins, this particular one is the worst. And to have that sin committed by one of Jesus' closest friends makes it even more disturbing. Jesus chose 12 men to go on mission with him. The key word here is he chose. One of these men would become the greatest sinner of all time, the great betrayer. Judas was with Jesus from the start of his earthly ministry, and it was Judas who was selected as the treasurer of the group. Let me ask you something. Who do you choose as the treasurer if you had a business? That's true. It's always someone you trust, right? That's who you're going to choose to watch over the money. I mean, to your point, that's why I chose Steve to be the treasurer of this church. First, because he's an accountant. He's knowledgeable, but he's also trustworthy. That's who you choose to handle the money. Judas had an important job, and he was chosen because they trusted him. Now, just 6 days before the Passover, Jesus, he's having dinner with the disciples. Martha, she's there, and she's serving them. And Judas is described as reclining at the table with Jesus. Mary, she took some really expensive oil. You remember the story. And she anointed Jesus' feet. She did this act as an act of love and kindness to the very person who would save her. Now, think about this scene here. Here's Judas watching Mary do this, and it creates some emotion. In fact, let's look at it real quick. Keep your marker here. Flip over to John 12:3. John 12:3. Mary then took a pound of very costly perfume of pure nard and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her what? With her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, who was intending to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and given to poor people?" Pause there. It kind of sounds like a good argument, doesn't it? Like, why would you waste all of that money on that perfume when we could give it away? We could give it to someone. But is that truly the concern of Judas? Let's read on. "Now he said this, not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a what? A thief. And as he kept the money box, he used to steal from what was put into it." Pause there. So this is a shocking reality. Here's Judas in this position of trust, and he would knowingly steal from their ministry. He would steal from the church. He didn't care about the poor. He only cared about filling his pockets with more money. Do you see that? You know, in a similar way, though, those that are outside the church, the unbeliever, they may question you. Well, why in the world do you give money to your church? Why do you even bother to plant churches in a country where you'll never even visit? Come on, spend your money on yourself. That's what our culture would say. They don't understand that the money you give is specifically to spread the gospel both here in our community and in foreign lands. A loving act that's more precious than any amount of money. I mean, think about it. How much, what price can you put on your salvation? Though we are mandated by God to give, we do so because we desire to give. And we do this with a cheerful heart. I pray that we will all be faithful like Mary, giving in a way that's shocking to the unbelieving world. Look at John 12:7. "Therefore, Jesus said," what? "Leave her alone, so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. For you always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." So Mary, she means well, but Judas tries to make that act of humility look bad and irresponsible. You might be looking at this story and saying, that's pretty outrageous. That's pretty ridiculous that Judas would do that. This guy, he's supposed to be a disciple, and yet he's stealing from the church. Newsflash, you know that's happening today. I mean, it doesn't take much for you to go on the internet and just type in prosperity, false prosperity gospel preachers. Just type it in. Watch what you see. You will see the spirit of Judas throughout many who proclaim to be ministers of the gospel. They're more interested in getting money than shepherding people. So Judas, chosen by Jesus, appointed as the treasurer, is stealing from the money bag, and yet no one knew. How is that? How is it that no one knew except Jesus? Pull out your outline. Let's answer question one. Why? Why was Judas stealing and plotting? Answer it. What do you think? The first answer to that question is the most obvious because we read it. It's money, right? But there's more. It goes further than that, though. Could you turn with me to Matthew 26:14? Matthew 26:14. Matthew 26:14. 14 through 16. We'll do that. Brian, you want to read that? Matthew 26, 14 through 16. Thank you. All right. So this comes right here directly after the story with Mary pouring out the perfumed oil. So what does Judas do immediately after that? It seems like money is the driving force, doesn't it? It seems like money is driving Judas to do this terrible act. How much money are we talking about? 30 pieces of silver, right? And you might think, well, that was probably quite a bit of money. No, it's actually equivalent to about $250 today. So, by the way, this was only a fraction of the money that Mary spent on that perfume. It was just a fraction. So the amount of money that was paid to betray Jesus was nothing. It was nothing. What a waste. So Judas did this for money. Yes, we see that, but there could be another possible reason. The other reason would be anger. Judas must have been angry because he's starting to realize that the gig is up for him. And Jesus told him, he told the disciples, hey, I'm going to go into Jerusalem and they are going to kill me. Let's go. Let's go into Jerusalem. Maybe Judas felt like he wouldn't be able to make money anymore. Or maybe Judas felt like all this time he had wasted his time. What drives that behavior, though? One word, sin. Sin drives that behavior. It's Judas' sin that causes him to react this way. Sin has literally broken everything. Sin is to be blamed for wars, famine, murder, greed, hate, and even the destruction of our planet. That's right, it's not your hairspray. You see, pull out your outline. Let's answer question two. Mankind has the ability to do the most heinous evil as demonstrated by the cross. The cross proves it. Shows us what we're capable of. The 1689 Baptist Confession of Faith says this: our first parents, by this sin, fell from their original righteousness and communion with God, and we in them, whereby death came upon all becoming dead in sin and wholly defiled in all the faculties and parts of soul and body. In other words, this sin disease is in us. It's in our DNA. And it has been passed on to every single human being from the beginning of time. And that sin has defiled every faculty of our soul and body. Though it's hard for us to imagine, without God, do you realize each one of us has the ability to betray just like Judas? Did this take Jesus by surprise? I mean, was Jesus sitting there like, whoa, I could have never seen that this would happen. I'm so surprised, Judas. Of course not. This was predetermined and foretold. God uses the sinful nature of mankind to achieve his will. He is not responsible for the sinful actions of people, no, but he can use it for good. The mysterious doctrine of God's providence combines human choices and the divine to bring certain actions to pass. Can you fill that in, please, in your outline? Providence. Let me give you an example of that. You remember Joseph and his brothers, don't you? Remember at the end of this story, remember when the brothers come to Joseph? He could have come against his brothers for selling him to slavery, but instead, you know what Joseph said? Joseph said, "You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good." Joseph understood that God's hand directed his circumstances, not his brothers. And though different, the evil things that Judas did would result in the most glorious act that would come to pass. You know what that act is? Our salvation. But Judas wasn't forced. He had his purpose. He had his intention. What was that? To betray Jesus so that Jesus would be murdered. And yet God's purpose was to redeem us by that very same act. What Judas meant for evil, God meant for good. Don't think that Judas is somehow a victim of fate. God didn't force Judas to betray. It was already in his heart. And yet, God planned this since the foundation of the world. Let me prove it to you. Turn to John 13:18. John 13:18. John 13:18. John 13:18. Bridget, you want to read that?
I do not speak of all of you. I know the ones I have chosen, but it is that the scripture may be fulfilled. He who eats my bread is lifted up his heel against me.
Okay. Jesus is quoting Psalm 41:9. Why is that important? Because it was foreordained. Do you see that? It was pre-planned. Now look at verse 19 now. From now on, I am telling you before it comes to pass, so that when it does occur, here it comes, when it does occur, you may believe that I am what?
I am.
Wow. Jesus is saying, I know I've chosen. I know that he's the devil. He is the man of perdition. But long ago, the scripture foretold that this would happen. So the actions of Judas would become the very reason for them to believe. Seriously? Like, who could plan this but God himself? Well, we wouldn't be smart enough to think of that. Did God force Judas? What's your answer? No. Did God know that this would happen? Did God rule over it? Yes, he did. He is the sovereign, holy, all-knowing, all-powerful God still in control. Pull out your outline. Let's answer question 4. This is human choice and divine sovereignty. I don't know why this thing is scaring you guys this morning. I apologize. Get ready for it. It could be coming again. Maybe it's me waving my arms around. Let's see what happens here. Human choice and divine sovereignty. By the way, this is a mystery that we will never fully understand until we get to heaven. And how does this apply to us today? Well, it helps us to better understand that God is in control. He is. God is in control. That we don't have to sit around and worry. We don't have to be anxious and frightened that the world is somehow spinning out of control. No, God knows everything that will happen, and nothing catches him by surprise. Nothing. Not COVID, not Joe Biden, not Putin, not Palestine. None of it. None of it is outside of his control. Don't you see? There is a plan that's being worked out right now. It is. And since we can't possibly know what the secret will of God is, you know what we are left to do, Frank? To trust. We must trust God, knowing that no matter what Satan devises for evil, God will mean it for good. Amen? He will mean it for good. That his plan will come to fruition exactly as he has planned. Let's go back to the Last Supper. Okay, so Jesus and the 12 disciples now, they're reclining around the table, enjoying food and conversation, and then an argument starts. Do you remember the argument over which one of them was the best? Look at this, Luke 22:24. And there arose also a dispute, an argument among them as to which one of them was regarded to be greatest. Like little kids arguing over something irrational. I'm daddy's favorite. No, I am. Do you remember how Jesus responds? What does he do? He very quietly walks over to the corner of the room while they're arguing. He removes his outer garment. He wraps a towel that's used by the house servant around his waist, and he bends down to wash their disgusting feet. Jesus countered their argument about who was the best by performing an act of humility to teach them a lesson. You know what the lesson is? It's not about you. It's not about your accolades. It's not about how great you are. You know what it's about? It's about serving and being humble. That's what it's about, disciples. It's about loving God and loving people. Jesus was doing the very act that they should have been doing to him. But they didn't. Because they couldn't see past their own selfish desires. You know, if we aren't careful, we can do the same exact thing. One, by doing things for the Lord so we can get some kind of recognition. Look at me, God. Look what I've done. Look at how great I am. Or even those who refuse to do things for God. You know why? Because they feel like it's beneath them. Oh, I can't do that. Vacuum the floors at church? Nope. Yeah, let somebody else do that. You know, I see many of you volunteer to clean this church each and every week. I love that. I love that. Cleaning and preparing your church, it isn't beneath you. You see it as a pleasure. And though people won't see what you're doing, they're not going to see your act of kindness and love. Can I submit this to you? God sees it. God sees it. He sees your selfless actions, and he adds them to your account. As Christians, we should always be looking for places to serve. We should be striving to serve with a humble, grateful attitude. I mean, if the King of all kings can stoop down and wash dirty feet, then there shouldn't be anything that we wouldn't be willing to humble ourselves to serve him. Pull out your outline. Let's answer question 5. Jesus provides a beautiful example of servanthood. Please fill that in. But it gets even crazier than that, doesn't it? Because Whose feet does Jesus wash? The very person we're describing, Judas, the great betrayer. And Jesus knew at that exact moment why he is scrubbing the feet of Judas, that within just a few hours, Judas would be plotting to murder him. Could you do that? I mean, if you knew someone was going to murder you in just a few hours, could you stoop down and begin to wash his feet? I don't think I could. In fact, Rob, I would bet I couldn't. That takes a special kind of love and humbleness, doesn't it? A special kind of love, a supernatural love. So they're reclining at the table, eating bread, and it sounds actually kind of tasty. They have this homemade bread that they dip in different sauces. And then the shot that was heard around the world. Jesus stuns them by saying, "Truly I say to you that one of you will betray me." What? The plot thickens, doesn't it? And the disciples, they're confused. Being deeply grieved, they each one began to say to him, "Surely not I, Lord. It's not me, is it?" And then Peter motions to John, and John is sitting right next to Jesus, okay? Peter's motioning. Find out who it is. Go to Jesus, ask him, "Who is that?" As I thought about it, why didn't every one of those disciples stand up and say, "We know who it is. It's Judas. Judas did it. Judas, he's the one." But they didn't. They didn't say that. Why didn't they say that? Because Judas was such a great deceiver. He was a sly wolf, and he fooled all of them, except, of course, Jesus, who answered with this, "It is he to whom I will give this morsel of bread when I dipped it." So when he had dipped the morsel, he gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. "You've been exposed, Judas. It's you. You're the betrayer." After this, remarkable verse. Satan entered him. What? Satan entered him. So Judas wasn't just demon possessed, he was actually Satan possessed. The answer to question 6, fill that in, please. So Satan enters into Judas. Now, according to the Gospel of Luke, it records that Satan actually entered Judas prior to the supper. And you might say, "Well, contradiction." No, it's not a contradiction. The truth is, Satan could have easily entered Judas more than once. We see that in the Scriptures with the evil spirits and demons. Why, though, would Satan enter him now? Is there a reason? I think maybe Judas started to have cold feet. You know what I mean, Ed? Like he's seeing this and he's starting to say, like that video, he's starting to have cold feet. He's starting to question what he's done. Maybe he was starting to weaken. But when Satan entered him, it may have intensified his sin of greed. The Bible doesn't give us the answers for these things, so we can only speculate. But now we know that Judas is being controlled and manipulated by Satan himself. And guess who knows it? Jesus knows it. He knows that Satan just entered into Judas. That's why he responds with this. Therefore, in other words, because of that, Jesus said to him, what you are doing, do it quickly. Go, Judas. Get out. Do it quickly. Judas had a lot to do, though. Have you ever thought about how many things Judas would have to do to get this done that night? First, he'd have to go and find the high priest. So he'd have to run. Find the high priest. And then he would have to convince the high priest, now's the time. Now's the time. And then the priests, you know what they would have to do? They would all have to convene. And then they would have to go and convince Pilate now. They'd have to convince him that this Jesus guy, he's even a threat to Rome and the stability of the city. And then they would have to go and get the Roman soldiers ready, equipped, ready to go, prepared. But they would also have to go get the temple guards. Do you remember them? They would go get the temple guards. They would get the elders of Israel and then the Pharisees. They would have to prepare. They needed a small army because they knew that Jesus had powers. They had witnessed it, and they just couldn't take a chance. But they also needed to do it at night when the crowds weren't around. So right now, in this moment, everything's in place. They had the people, they had the religious leaders, they had the torches and weapons, and now they were ready to go and get Jesus. Look what John 18:3 says. So Judas, having obtained the Roman what? Okay, think about that for a moment. Having obtained the Roman cohort and officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees came there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Okay, a Roman cohort was a tenth of a legion. You know how many soldiers that is? 600. 600 men? What? To go and capture an innocent man? I don't know, Jeremy, it seems a little excessive, wouldn't you say? 600 men? Satan-possessed Judas was a busy little bee, wasn't he? During this time, Jesus, he starts to prepare his disciples. He starts to prepare them for what is about to occur. Jesus knows. They enjoy the Lord's Supper together, and then Jesus says, truly I say to you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God, which actually begins communion, the Lord's Supper. They go and they sing a hymn. And then Jesus gives them another prediction. Look at this, Mark 14:27. You will all what? You will all fall away. Why? Because it is written, I will strike down the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. Do you realize even the disciples fulfill Old Testament prophecy? So they go to Gethsemane, and Jesus, he tells the disciples, you guys sit here and pray, and he takes his inner circle with him. Do you remember who that is? Peter? Peter, James, and John. That's his inner circle, right? And he takes them with him, and he says, okay, we've gone far enough. You know, you guys sit here and you guys pray. But they can't, don't they? But they should have been awake. They should have been praying for strength. They should have been praying about the evil things that Jesus was telling them that's going to happen. Have you ever had something in your life where it's traumatic, it's terrible, and instead of turning to prayer, you try to solve it on your own? I mean, you don't even include God at all. only to be left disappointed. But the first place a Christian should turn when things are bad is prayer. It should be the first place. Don't get caught sleeping. We are to take it to the Lord. Here's the point. Pull out your outline. Point one, trust in God's control and plan. Control and plan. Seen through Jesus' humble servanthood, even in the face of betrayal and impending trials. Okay, let's go back to the scene now. Jesus, he's in the garden, right? He just tells these disciples, why are you guys sleeping? Get up, etc. And you can hear in the distance, do you hear it? The clanking of metal, almost like swords clanking together. I can hear it. You hear the footsteps. You hear the sounds of the crowd murmuring and talking. They're getting close now. They're coming. Jesus, he goes and he wakes up the disciples. It's time. It's time. Behold, the one who betrays me is at hand. Remember, this isn't a few people. This is a massive crowd. Estimates are as high as 1,000 people coming to get Jesus. My favorite part of the story. Jesus calls out to them with a rhetorical question, who are you looking for? They respond, Jesus of Nazareth. Then Jesus gives them the Old Testament name for God, for himself. I am he. And when he does, the very words of Jesus causes this crowd to fall down on the ground. Just through his words. They knew it. What? This is no ordinary man. But they were driven by evil. They were being led by the evil one. And nothing would stop them. And then the kingpin comes forward. The betrayer himself, Judas. Judas told them that the signal would be the kiss on Jesus' cheek. You see, Judas, he wanted to make sure the signal is clear. He didn't want any miscommunication here. And by the way, that's why he's being paid in the first place. And I need you to remember, it's very dark. Even though there was a full moon, they were in an olive grove. There would be lots of branches and trees all around them. And by the way, there were 11 other suspects there. So Judas, he had to make it obvious. I wonder, however, were the disciples starting to get it now? What do you think? I mean, to see Judas, he was one of us. What's he doing? Why is he leading this crowd? Judas, he was one of us. Jesus sent us out two by two. He was healing. He was performing miracles. He heard all of the words of Jesus. He saw all that Jesus did and we trusted him. I mean, he watched over the money. And now he's coming forward to point out Jesus? And Judas moves forward and says this, greetings, Rabbi. Wow. And then he moves in to kiss the altogether lovely and pure cheek of Jesus. You know, when I go to India, you know, they don't shake hands, which is probably a good idea nowadays with the stuff we have running around. You know what they do instead? They do this. Now, if you go there and they revere you, you know what they do? They go like this. And sometimes if they know you're a preacher, I found it weird at first, but they'll come up and they'll randomly touch your knee. And sometimes if they really revere you, they'll go down and they'll touch your foot. I'm like, what's the deal here, man? These are gestures of respect and admiration. In biblical times, you know what they would do? They actually kiss the hem of their garment to express reverence. But, think about this. A hug and a kiss, totally different. Totally different. A hug and a kiss was a sign of affection towards your equal. It was a sign of love and gratitude. And this is what makes this act of treachery so ugly, that Judas would demean Jesus with this act of love. Think about that. I wonder what that kiss on his cheek was like. It was probably burning to the touch, because it was a kiss of death. Maybe that's why Proverbs 27:6 says this: faithful are the wounds of a friend, but deceitful are the kisses of an enemy. Then Jesus says this: friend, do what you are here to do. Then they came and took hold of Jesus and arrested him. Now the disciples know exactly what's happening. Now they get it. Because according to Luke's account, the disciples say, Lord, should we use our sword? Probably something I would do. I think that's why me and Peter were. Peter jumps up, pulls out the sword, and cuts off the right ear of Malchus. Remember that? A servant of the high priest. And then Jesus performs another amazing miracle right in front of them by healing this man's ear. They still don't get it, though, do they? They arrest him, and then the disciples run for their lives. Now Jesus is alone. He's alone with these evil men, for his time has now come. Judas, the great betrayer, has achieved his mission. Could you turn to Matthew 27 with me? Matthew 27, verse 3. Matthew 27, verse 3. Matthew 27, 3. And when Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that he had been condemned, he felt remorse and returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned by betraying innocent blood. But they said, what is that to us? See to that yourself. And he threw the pieces of silver into the temple sanctuary and departed. And he went away and what? He went away and killed himself. So the question remains, was Judas a Christian? I want to allow the Bible to tell us. Could you go now to John 17:12? John 17:12. By the way, this is called the high priestly prayer of Jesus. Here's Jesus. He's praying to the Father. John 17:12. While I was with them. That's Jesus with the disciples, right? While I was with them, I was keeping them in your name, which you have given me, and I guarded them, and not one of them perished. That doesn't mean physical death. That's spiritual death in hell. Not one of them perished, but the son of what? Perdition. So that the scripture would be fulfilled. Counselor, have I made my case? 100%. Pull out your outline. Let's answer question 7. The son of perdition. Why does the scripture tell us that? It means the man who is doomed to destruction. Perdition means eternal damnation or hell. Of course, Judas was not a Christian. The son of perdition is used twice in the Bible. It's used here for Judas Iscariot. You know who else it's used for? In 2 Thess, it's used to describe the Antichrist. Okay. Hold on to that thought for a moment. Can a true Christian then be demon-possessed? What do you think, yes or no? The simple answer is no. Read this one with me, 1 Corinthians 6:19. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, where? Within you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own. Where does the Holy Spirit reside? In us, right? The Holy Spirit and a demonic spirit cannot coexist within the same person. That's the point. Fill that in the answer to question 8, coexist. And frankly, it's unthinkable that God would allow one of his children, whom he purchased with his blood, whom he made new, to then be controlled by a demon. No. In fact, 1 John 4:4 says, you are from God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he, that's God, who is in you than he, that's Satan, who is in the world. Satan cannot overwhelm or overcome the Holy Spirit. He can't. Besides, there isn't one, not one legitimate example of a true believer being demon-possessed. Not one. Someone might say, well, wait a minute. Didn't Jesus say, get behind me, Satan, to Peter? Do you remember that? But that's not a good example, because the scripture doesn't say that Satan entered him. He was influenced by Satan, yes, because in that moment, Satan was trying to stop Jesus from going to the cross. Here's the point, pull out your outline, point 2. There isn't any biblical proof that a true Christian can be demon-possessed. But you know what? With all of that being said, what you should never, ever do, beloved, listen to me. Don't ever challenge Satan. Bring it, Satan. No, don't ever do that. We need to stay away from the occult, tarot cards, all of those things. Satan is called the accuser of the brethren in Revelation 12:10. Why is that? Because he attempts to harm us. He attempts to harm us when we stumble, when we sin. He wants us to think that we cannot be forgiven. He wants us to believe that we are useless in God's kingdom, but is a lie from the father of lies. I want you to turn to one of my favorite verses. Are you ready? I'm sure this is already underlined. Turn to John 6:37. I want to step out of the way. I just want you to read it. John 6:37. You see it? Matt, what does that say there?
Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me, I certainly will not cast out.
Can you see it? I mean, there should be a room full of amens right now.
I should be. Jesus will certainly not cast us out. That's why I believe in the old phrase, once saved, always saved. You know why? Because that's exactly what Scripture teaches. That's why. Flip over to John 10, 27, 28. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give eternal life to them, and they will never perish. Never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. No one. So a couple of quick applications. As I noticed my wife giving me a look like, you better shut it down. Is there someone in your life that you need to serve? Like somebody who's hurting, somebody, a friend, a relative? Maybe someone you could send a thoughtful card to. Maybe someone you could give a couple of dollars to with a little Bible verse attached to it. Is there someone you know that's in a bad place right now and you need to go and encourage them with the Scriptures? Do it. Don't wait. And if you feel like you've been more focused on yourself rather than helping others, you can change that today. Lastly, we need to go to those who are lost, those who have rejected God, and we need to consider doing acts of service and starting a conversation about Jesus. Like Frank said, while there is still time. And then we need to invite them to our church. Let me close with this. Three men who spent lots of time with Jesus, who claimed to be a true Christian, Judas, Peter, and Thomas. Jesus said, one will betray me, one will deny me, and one wouldn't believe. Judas betrayed Jesus and he died in his sin. Peter denied Jesus, but he repented and has eternal life. And the apostle Thomas, who wouldn't believe, who when he saw the risen Christ, he repented and said, my Lord and my God. How about you? Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, that he died for your sins, that he rose again, that he now sits at the right hand of the Father interceding for his people today? If you believe it and confess it, you will be saved. If not, come to Christ while you still can. Place your faith where God has placed your sins, on Jesus. Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you again for your word. Your word that's so amazing. Though we are shocked and saddened by the treachery of Judas, we can see that it was used by you for our good. Help us, O God, to see the triumphant Savior when we're in trouble or when we feel overwhelmed. Thank you, God, for this church. And thank you for all who have attended today that are watching online. May you watch over them and protect them until we meet again on the next Lord's Day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together and sing. Come let us adore.
for coming today. I hope this service was a great blessing to you. God is truly doing a work here in this beautiful little church. So be encouraged, Christian, as we go out and proclaim his name. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you.